Hi, I'm Chef Mick from Tony's Market. Welcome to my kitchen. Who doesn't love pizza? They say that on any given day, 13% of North America eats pizza. Who knew? Most folks order pizza out, but they're missing all the fun. The joy of pizza comes from making it, especially the dough. Making dough and pizza with your kids or friends is the most fun you'll have in the kitchen all year long. Naples is the birthplace of pizza, and they're famous for the dough, thanks to Caputo double lot flour. An extra fine, soft wheat flour with high protein levels, perfect for soft, stretchy, and chewy doughs. You can make a great pizza in an hour or two, or start 1-2 days ahead for an even chewier crust. Stay right there, I'll show you how. It's easy. You can make a great dough and pizza in as little as an hour using Caputo flour and a classic yeast. Don't let yeast scare you. It does all the work and it's really easy. I truly prefer the Caputo yeast, but you can use any yeast. Personally, I didn't care for the rapid rise yeast. The yeast is dried and dormant, so let's dissolve 2¼ teaspoons in exactly 1 cup of warm water, 105 to 115 degrees. And then we're going to add 1/2 teaspoon of sugar, yeast food, and then in 5 minutes it's ready to use. Just look how active this Caputo yeast is. There are several other methods, but this one is fast and consistent, and if the yeast doesn't bloom, you can avoid spoiling the whole batch. As the yeast blooms, measure out your flour. You need exactly 3 cups, so measure by scooping into your cup gently and then slice or slide the top layer off. Each cup is 5 ounces. Personally, I don't use a measuring cup. I just weigh out 15 ounces of flour. Baking's not like other cooking. It's actually chemistry, so there are formulas to be followed. But you know the formula, it's easy. Next, we'll add 1¾ teaspoons of salt to the flour and 3 tablespoons of olive oil to the blooming yeast and fold it all together with the mixer in a dough hook. Or you can pull it all together into a dough with a silicone spatula and knead by hand. Even with exact measurements, the moisture level will vary. I always work to have the moistest dough that I can handle. Moisture dough is easier to stretch and it simply turns out better. Usually I need to adjust with just a touch of water. Add no more than 1 teaspoon at a time and mix, checking for a light stickiness with your hands. This dough was feeling kind of dry, it was crumbly at the bottom, a lot of flour at the bottom, and it just wasn't coming together. So I added scant splashes of water and mixed it until it was just right. Your job's pretty easy. Pay attention to the moisture level, adjusting with small amounts of water or flour, and let the mixer do all the work kneading. Mechanical kneading develops gluten proteins. That's what makes breads chewy and satisfying. The kneading process takes only about 5 minutes with a mixer, maybe 10 minutes by hand, so get the guys to do it for you if you need. When kneading by hand, consider working the dough right in the same big bowl that you'll use for fermentation. This saves a little time on cleanup. It's done when it feels soft, silky, and stretchy. It just takes a couple of times to master this kneading process, and I find the soft, silky doughs, the way they feel, are particularly satisfying. There's something about that texture that mere humans cannot resist. Shape it into a dough ball, stretching the ends to the bottom, and then add olive oil and toss, coating both the dough and the bowl well with oil. Finally, soak a towel in hot water, squeeze it out, and use it to cover the dough, adding humidity to the proofing process. We're making the fastest dough we can, so to speed things up, I warm the oven slightly before I start it, turn it off, and then try to balance the temperature at roughly 80 to 90 degrees. At a humid 80 to 90 degrees, the dough will double in about an hour and be ready to use, or you could rest 4 to 8 hours at room temperature or for 1 to 5 days in the refrigerator. When fermented slowly in the refrigerator, the dough develops more character and chewiness. Fresh dough is great. Long fermented dough is better, if you've got the time. When we were doing pizza at our downtown market, we fermented our dough refrigerated for about 3 days, and it was among the best I ever tasted. But this quick method is what I usually do at home. Let's switch gears and make a quick sauce. This is my favorite, and remember, the better quality of the tomatoes, the better the sauce will be. Yeah, there's a difference. I start with 2 tablespoons of olive oil and about 1 clove or 1/2 teaspoon of minced garlic. Saute lightly and add 28-ounce can of crushed tomatoes, preferably Italian, and 6-ounce can of Italian tomato paste. Then add 3/4 teaspoon of salt, 1½ to 2 teaspoons of Tony's Italian herb medley, 1/4 teaspoon of black pepper, and 1 to 3 pinches of crushed red pepper, if you like, and 1 teaspoon of sugar. This simmers covered for about 15 minutes. You can taste and adjust, but I focus on a rich, sweet tomato flavor that merely enhanced by a little bit of salt, herbs, and garlic. If you don't feel like making pizza sauce, I suggest the Rao's brand jarred sauce. Both my homemade sauce and the Rao's are excellent with calzones and strombolis as well. I'm also cooking off some Italian sausage. Try not to break it up too much and just cook it till it's done. It'll cook more later on the pizza. I also love meatballs on my pizza, so I brought some home from our deli and sliced them up. They're actually my great-grandmother's old recipe. Once the dough is up, crank the oven up as high as it goes. Most home ovens will go around 500 degrees, but it takes a while. A proper pizza oven cooks at 800 or so degrees on a stone bed. To emulate this, you can use a ceramic pizza stone or a cast iron or aluminum griddle to focus the oven's heat. Deeper baking pans or cast iron skillets are the best pans for thick pizzas, but they don't get preheated. You don't have all that? Just preheat the biggest and heaviest baking sheet you've got. Okay, the dough's up, the oven's hot, and the toppings are ready to go. Let's make some pizza. These dough balls are enough for four individual pizzas or two large pizzas, so I'm going to cut them smaller. If you really want round pizzas, you'll need to make 2 to 4 dough balls and then rise them separately. But I'm not worried about the final shape, so I'm just cutting the final dough. First, we'll make New York style, which is the thin crust of even thickness. I start by evening out the dough, then stretching it out by hand. If you want it extra thin, you can use a roller, but you still want to finish it by hand. Tossing at the end isn't only fun, but it stretches the dough a little bit more as it dries the surface, which affects the final texture. Once you're ready to start putting on toppings, put on a generous sprinkle of semolina flour or cornmeal works great. This will help keep it from sticking to your peel and to the pan. Toppings are where so many folks go wrong. Even half the pizzerias put on too many toppings. Too much on top and the crust just won't cook right. Keep in mind, a proper bake is paramount for great pizza. Spread it with your sauce, pushing it close to the edge, and top evenly with your favorite toppings. This is the absolute max I can put on and still get a decent bake. The layer of cornmeal we put under the pizza allows it to slide on and off the peel easily. You don't have a peel? You can just use a cookie sheet to great effect. Or just make your pizza on top of parchment paper, transferring it to a pan by hand. Now into the oven for 5 minutes, rotate 90 degrees, and keep baking until the crust and the toppings start to brown, about 3 minutes longer in my oven. Remove to a wire rack for 1 to 2 minutes to cool slightly, and then it's ready to cut and serve. Classic New York pizza generally has an even thickness from end to end and a light to medium amount of toppings and cheese. For the best success, keep the toppings light and focus on a great bake. Andiamo a Napoli. Let's go to Napoli, the birthplace of pizza. The dough is exactly the same, but different handling makes a world of difference in the bake. For this crust, we'll stretch it differently, keeping the edges thick and the center as thin as you dare. I like to hold onto the crust and let the dough's weight sag to do the stretching. I would not use a roller at all. Just stretch the middle as thin as you can and keep the edges nice and thick. Add plenty of semolina or cornmeal or parchment paper underneath and spread the sauce in the center, keeping a good distance away from the edge. That was a little messy. We want the edges to stay perfectly clean. Use a minimum amount of toppings, just tomato sauce, fresh mozzarella, and basil is the classic. I like mine with a couple slices of prosciutto as well. To me, this is the best pizza of all, but that's what you get when you make your own, a perfect pizza for your taste buds every single time. How do you feel about thick Sicilian pizza, Chicago-style deep dish, or stuffed pizza? Decadent Detroit style, California style, calzones, garlic knots, focaccia, stromboli. This dough is perfect for all of them, but I'm out of time. Hopefully we'll get back to more great recipes you can make with this dough. There's even a gluten-free version that tasted great. Hope to do them all in upcoming videos.
Anybody can make great pizza. It just takes a little practice, and practicing pizza with family and friends is a lot of fun. Great pizza starts with great dough, so pick up a bag of imported Italian Caputo 00 flour and let's all start a family pizza night tradition. Let everybody get their hands dirty shaping the dough and creating their own masterpiece. That's the kind of family tradition that brings folks closer together while feeding the body and the soul. I'm Chef Mick. I thank you for shopping in our markets, and I thank you for joining me in my kitchen.